Roman Harper, welcome back to Tuscaloosa. I hope all is well, man.
All is great, man. 11 years. It's all good.
11 years. Oh, my heavens, man. I shorted you a year, which is, you know, big pay for a guy like you. Yeah, so my apologies.
All good.
Man, give us an update, man. Where are you at these days? How are you spending time away from football?
Man, I'm in Charlotte, North Carolina, man. I'm retired, being a stay-at-home dad, low-end. I do some TV stuff here and there, man, a lot of TV stuff, a lot of radio, and just being really enjoying that aspect of life. And I would call, hey, look, man, it's the struggle every day, you know. My goal in the morning is just to make it to breakfast, you know what I mean? Make it through breakfast, all right? And then after that, we can get some leadway going, a little bit of momentum.
Okay.
You know, getting the kids going. My youngest daughter loves dressing herself, so we don't really have to worry about dressing her anymore. She's 4, and she's she wants to pick her own clothes, so I just let her go. My oldest daughter, she's in first grade, so she has a little bit more of a dress code, so we got to help her out a little bit. But, you know, it's challenging. Every day is a different day. And, you know, when you have 3 young kids, we got 6, 4, and 2, man, every day is just a different day. And,
Okay. You
know, it's just work, man. I give a lot of these moms and other parents that stay at home with their kids and get stuff done, I give them a lot more credit, man, especially now that I do it myself. It's nothing to it's not a very appeasing job, and you don't get a lot of accolades and, you know, rewards and a lot of praise. But trust me, man, I give it to all those women and men that do that on a daily basis, man. It's a beautiful thing, and it's very you don't see the results really either as much and as like you do football, where everybody sees you make plays and all these other things. And when you're being just a stay-at-home parent, man, it's just you and the kids, man. And the kids enjoy it sometimes. They don't really care. They don't look at you as anything special. You're just mom or dad.
All right. So what would the kids say about dad's cooking? Do you have skills behind the stove? I mean, do you have skills?
Oh, no.
Or no?
No, not at all. I'm more of a breakfast. I can make eggs and a little bit of breakfast cereal. I can do that all day.
Okay.
And also, I'm more of a guy on the grill. I like the grill. You got steak, chicken. Anything on the grill I can handle, but mostly anything in the kitchen I try and stay away from and let my wife handle that. That and hair. I don't do hair either. I don't do that. And if my biggest thing is if I don't never start learning how to do it, I won't ever have to do it. So that's what I depend on.
No, 100%. I mean, I had a daughter, and the hair thing was always such a, like, my wife would make fun of me because, you know, I'd have the little pigtails, the ponytails hanging on the wrong side. I mean, it was just that's a real challenge for dads. I don't know if the moms really understand how much of a challenge that is for us, but it's just, I found it very awkward as well. But Roman, I want to go back to when you committed to the University of Alabama. Can you walk us through your decision to go to the University of Alabama and commit to this wonderful university? Can you walk us through the process?
Yeah, man, it's pretty easy for me. So with me, I had kind of decided at an early stage I was going to stay within the state. I had offers outside of the state, but my mom had asked me to stay close because my brother had just signed at Troy University, well, Troy State at the time, the previous year. So my freshman year was his sophomore year, and they didn't miss games, so they like to travel and go to each game, and it was going to be a lot easier if I stayed closer to home. So I had every school in the state wanting me, and there's a couple fine universities all throughout the state. So I was like, okay, cool. So I looked at it, and it came down between Alabama and Auburn, which a lot of kids in state have to have those same issues. And let me tell you, I made my decision based on 3 things, and I tell everybody this. Number one, the colors, all right? Crimson is to say it's close to what I had at Prattville, which is like a red maroonish color, so at least I knew I looked good in it. Versus like blue and orange, that was a lot different look. That was one reason. The second reason was Alabama was Nike, and I had Russell Athletic in high school, and Auburn was Russell Athletic at the time. So I was like, I'm ready to upgrade in that area. And then the last one was I liked my DB coach a little bit better than I did at the one at Auburn. The one at Auburn seemed like he was like, you know, he had already had some other guys he kind of liked ahead of me. And the one at Alabama seemed like I was the only one. So those were my decisions. And at 17, 18 years old, these are the things that make life decisions that are based on these 3 reasons.
Roman, when you look at Alabama, going to the University of Alabama, when you talk about committing to the University of Alabama, let's just be honest. there were some struggles. There were some hurdles that you guys all had to get over and to build Alabama to get that back. Do you look back and say, you know, I helped lay that foundation that Nick Saban, obviously, when he walked in, he was sitting there with a, you know, a decent foundation to continue the success that you guys were built on, because Alabama went through some probation, went through some sanctions, and, you know, the NCAA kind of hit us in the mouth, but we sort of got up off the mat.
Yeah, you know, I don't really look at myself like, you know, I had something to do with all this and that. Look, I just flat out being honest with it. When I was there, Alabama was just not as good as where we are right now. And a lot of that had to do with probation and all those other things, because the year before I got there, they just went through the SEC championship. So all these things kind of play within itself, and it's amazing what a lack of scholarships, and then you allow that to affect the whole program, because other coaches are recruiting against that, saying, hey, they're not going to be as good, they're not going to have this, or all these other things, and we couldn't go to bowl game for 2 years, which didn't turn out bad because I got to go to Hawaii. So I wasn't all the way mad at that. But at the end of the day, what it really laid the foundation for me was the group of guys that I came in with, Shad Williams, Charlie Pepper, Freddie Roach, Todd Bates, all these guys that have been so successful since playing football, Anthony Madison, all these other, Mark Anderson, all these guys came in. We all came in together, and when we got put on probation, we really just locked arms together, because you couldn't transfer then. It wasn't like it is now where, you know, you could just up and leave if something's not going right or you're not starting. And you had to at least be a junior or something like that when you got put on probation to go into the transfer thing. So we were locked in, and there was nothing we could do about it besides, hey, you know, pull up our pants and let's get ready to go do this thing. We all played out of early year. They redshirted as many of us as they could our freshman year just to hold on to us for as long as they could. And then that redshirt freshman year, we all rode in there trying to get starting positions. And we all started or played at a high-end role early in our careers because of it.
All right, so when you were naming off the names, whether it was Anthony Madison, Charlie Pepper, Mark Anderson, which played at Chicago for quite a while and was a great sack guy, you went through the names. Todd Bates is over at Clemson. But, you know, the one thing that when you were naming all those names, I think about the fraternity and the brotherhood that you guys had. And I'm sure that was probably formed with some of the things that you were talking about a couple of minutes ago. But when you were naming all those names, I saw a family, because, you know, D'Amico Ryans, Freddie Roach, I mean, you guys were tight as a fraternity.
Yeah, man, we got so good at one point defensively. Like, we would run our own practice just about. Coach Kynes was there, but if we missed for the run, we knew we messed up. And because of the trials and tribulations that we had been through and all the different coaches and all the different situations, all we had were each other. It wasn't like we had this plethora of rotation where they're rotating guys in on second down versus third down rush guys and all. It was just our starting 11. We didn't have anybody else. We rotated a couple of nickel guys in Simeon Castile and Jeffrey Duke. But other than that, it was just us. And we played with it just like that. We didn't have the rotation and all the other guys and all the other highly touted guys and things like that. It was just us. And because of that, man, we depended on each other. We loved each other. We fought with each other. But at the end of the day, we loved and cared about each other more than anything else. And we never let anybody break that bond that we have. We all are still very tight and close-knit now. We all still communicate, and we all still hang out together, man, as much as we can. And I'm so happy and successful. And when I see other guys like Todd Bates or like Freddie Roach or like D'Amico Ryans who are coaching at high-end levels and doing great things, or like Charlie Pepper who's scouting and, you know, and other things like that.
Shad Williams is up in Oregon.
Shad's up there in Oregon. Yeah, he's a strength coach. So, and Shad came in with us. So, you know, he didn't stay the whole time because he was a junior transferring over from Texas Tech. But these are guys and relationships that I get to carry on the rest of my life. And that's what I tell people, that Alabama means the most to me. And trust me, when I go there now, they treat me great. Coach Saban and Coach Cochran and those guys, they open the doors for me and treat me awesome. But the relationships that I've been able to build from this school and this university is what I take back with me more often than not. And when I walk around with an Alabama shirt or something like that in the city of Charlotte, North Carolina, people are still – give me so much respect because, hey, I am Alabama. I am Roll Tide, and it goes with me for the rest of my life.
And, man, that is awesome. And certainly we talk about Roman Harper here joining us as we continue talking about Alabama football. You also had a chance to go through the New Orleans Saints. And when we talk about passionate fan bases, they certainly qualify. And even the last couple of weeks with the Super Bowl, and I love it, man. I mean, I love the passion of New Orleans, and it's always a fun place to visit, man. Can you describe that fan base?
Yeah, man. It's very unique. It's a very college atmosphere type place, because you got to think about it. Louisiana, they don't have a ton of big college football programs. You got Tulane and LSU, and that's it. You know, you got UL Lafayette and some other things, but everybody loves the Saints, whether it's the Gulf Coast. I'm very happy to admit that I think I had a little bit to do with the state of Alabama actually becoming more of a Louisiana, more of a New Orleans type feel and winning a fan base as well, because, you know, everybody likes Drew Brees. I came from Alabama. We were successful when I was there. Those things like that kind of bring up a larger part of the fan base. And the state of Louisiana is different, man. Also, it's not like your other big city or NFL type cities where you got all this metropolitan and all these people move in for big jobs and big businesses. That's not it. If you're in New Orleans, man, you're pretty much born and raised there. And that gives you a different type of feel. You love the Saints. You've been there when they were bad. You've been there when they're good. And that's all you know. Big businesses don't exist there. The biggest business that they have is hotels and things like that. So that's it in tourism. So if you live in Louisiana, or if you're from New Orleans, Louisiana, you're born and raised there, and that's why you love the Saints, and that's your team, and you love them like no other.
All right. Now, we're all Alabama fans, everybody that you name. But can you think of anybody that's a bigger Alabama fan than Mark Ingram?
No, Mark reps pretty hard, man. And he's one of those, so, you know, you got to understand, like, I had ups and downs when I was in college. He had no downs. It was all up for him. SEC championship, leaving in a national championship, going back, winning a Heisman. He's one of our most decorated players we've ever had in that school's history. And he always goes hard. He's in the perfect state because we like picking on LSU and all these Louisiana fans because, you know, they hate Alabama. And it's not really because, like, it's a big rivalry. It was a big rivalry, and it's only because Nick Saban's there. It wasn't like it was a huge rivalry before. We got Tennessee and Auburn. Those were our big rivalries. But since Nick Saban's got there, the rivalry has really jumped up. And it's all because they're just mad because Nick Saban's not there anymore. He's like dating Beyonce in high school, you know? It's like he's moved on to bigger and better things, and they're not happy about it. And it's not like he left them to come to Alabama. He left them to go to Miami and didn't work out there, and then he came to Alabama. And it's just perfect timing, and Mark is the perfect person to look up and be like, oh, man, this guy's an Alabama guy. Only thing would have been better if he was from Alabama.
No doubt. I mean, but you see Mark, I mean, man, he's just a passionate Alabama fan. I mean, I feel like I need to take my game to the next level when I'm around Mark Ingram. I mean, but hey, listen, I want to ask you, on your living room, in your office, in your study, there's got to be a photo of Rocky Stop, right? I mean, please tell me that there is one hanging on your wall somewhere there in Charlotte.
It's not actually up, actually. It's at my parents' house back home. They got a copy of it, and I got my own too, but I just haven't put it on the wall here in Charlotte. I'm actually going to bring it back with me pretty soon, one of my next visits back home to Prattville. Because once I moved from New Orleans, I moved a whole bunch of pictures, paintings, and stuff all down, and I just haven't moved them all up here yet. So I got a place on the wall, though. It's going to be there. I got also another Alabama picture. This guy gave it to me. I traded him something. And I got a big picture of me, Juwan Simpson, and Anthony Madison. I got an interception. I was running back. And these guys were – Juwan was pretending to block for me. I think Anthony was maybe trying to get a block. But Juwan definitely didn't block anybody. And I sent it to both of them. And they signed it for me and sent it back, so I got it in a big frame.
Where's Ann at now? Where's Madison at?
Anthony's actually in Orange County, California, in Anaheim.
Okay, cool, okay.
Yeah, man, he got full disability from the NFL, and he's actually found the Lord in a high end, and he's working with the church out there and really doing some great things. Juwan is actually in Decatur back home. He's coaching up there in Decatur, he and his wife. I think she's a nurse, so. And he's looking to try and move up in the coaching world. So he's pursuing other dreams in that thing.
Man, you guys, you're just bringing back some great memories, having a chance to be around you guys, working at the athletic department, running the website, Crimson Tradition. I mean, man, Anthony Madison, it was a lot of fun to be able to I'll give you guys a little secret. Anthony Madison used to help me with apparel because, see, for some reason – they would give you guys those good-looking Alabama shirts, but us guys that were student assistants, we just didn't get those. And Anthony Madison was my go-to guy for making sure that I had the proper Nike apparel to represent the University of Alabama.
Dude, you got to have it, man, especially on campus. That gear is gold. I mean, you can trade. You can get better grades with that stuff. All that stuff matters, man. And I'm just glad Ant was hooking you up, because I remember when Anthony first got on campus, dude, he had number 38. It was the ugliest number I'd ever seen in my life. And it was just funny how they treated you when you first get on campus, at least back then. You know, we had to earn it. We had older guys like Thal and Gerald Dixon and all these other guys. So, you know, we had to learn how to, you know, be college players and kind of learn our way around, man. And I'm just so happy that, you know, like I said, we all still keep up with each other. When we call each other, everybody answers and nobody has any beef. We all very, very truly just love and genuinely love and care for each other.
Hey, Roman, final couple of questions. You had a chance to play, and certainly Drew Brees is a I love his character. I think he's great. When you talk about just being a perfect professional, talk about what it was like to build that relationship, because Drew Brees, we thank him in so many different ways, because if he doesn't go to New Orleans and he goes to Miami, Nick Saban probably never makes it to Tuscaloosa, because Drew Brees probably turns around the Dolphins and helps Nick Saban win Super Bowls instead of national titles here at your alma mater.
Hey, look, man, you know what? I don't thank Drew enough for that, actually. But, look, man, Drew is exactly what everybody paints him as. And he does it on all levels, man. He's a great family guy, great husband, father. He's the first one to work, last one to leave. So he puts it in the work, the time and the work, to be the best constant professional that he can be on the field, off the field. He's doing all these other different endeavors. He's, building his son's character with all the football leagues and all the other things that he does for our Navy and our Air Forces and things like that. So he really is. He does it on all factors, man. He's just a constant professional, man, and he's a great guy. He's very easy to get along with. And as I see him continue to age, he continues to reinvent himself and find ways to connect and get along with these younger guys in the locker room, because the NFL locker room continues to get younger every year. And Drew continues to find himself just right in the mix with all of them, whether it's dancing, doing all the young things, because you got to be able to find a way to connect with these guys. It's not like in college where everybody's around the same age. In the NFL, you got a lot of older vet guys, you got some very young guys, man. And at the end of the day, man, that's what it's all about, is coming together as quick as you can every offseason, every training camp, to build the best team, because the team is not the same. 60% of the team, 65% of the team is different every year in the NFL.
Final question. From a defensive back perspective, what do you see in this hotshot quarterback by the name of Tua Tagovailoa here in T-Town?
I think he's very accurate. This is the only challenge, the only question mark I have for Tua Tagovailoa is this. When you take a hit, are you going to be tough enough to get up, show your team that you're here for the long haul, and I'm willing to do whatever it takes to put my team over the top? When I take a hit, I got to be able to get up. I got to be able to show the toughness, the desire to win. And I see the desire to win. I see the pretty balls. I see the accuracy, the concern. The answers after the game are beautiful. All that's great. But you got to be tough, mentally desirable. I think he was humbled a little bit after last year, the way it ended for him. And I think he's going to be hungry to go out there and prove it to everybody that he is the number one quarterback in this country, and he's going to go out there and do it. I mean, and a left-handed ball just looks prettier. Just plain and simple, it does. And it is what it is. He's big enough. He's got the arm strength. He's going to be one of the top quarterbacks to take in if he leaves early next year. And or he could be like most some guys. And, hey, they just really enjoy college and enjoy the aspect of being your brother's teammate and things like that, man. That goes a lot further than what it is. And not everybody's out there chasing the dollar, man. Some people really enjoy college. And I know I did. I would have stayed on campus another year if they'd have let me, but I had to go.
What, but now do you see, because there's some similarities they talk about with Drew Brees. It's hard to compare one of the greatest quarterbacks of all time to a sophomore in college, but can you see a little similarities between the two?
Oh, well, I think he just has great anticipation and accuracy. That's the biggest thing. And he's not the most agile. I mean, he's an agile. He's way more mobile than Drew. Younger Drew was probably a little bit more mobile, and Drew still is athletic. He's just slow because he's 40 now. So that's just what it is. But, you know, Tua's not going to be looked at like, oh, this guy's a legit runner in the NFL either. So all these things, and he's not the tallest quarterback. He's not a staggering 6'4", 6'5", 6'6", quarterback. So all those things, that's about all the comparison I got for you. And at the end of the day, you got to keep doing it at the highest level. And Tua's got a lot of weapons around him that he can spread the ball all over the field and do all these other things. And he's got all the tools in the toolbox to be a great quarterback. And he just has to keep doing it, man. The sample size is not big enough for me to want to just go all in and buy all the stocks. But, hey, he's got a great start, man, and this guy is something special. And he's just got to keep believing in himself keep bringing that team along and prove that he's the number one leader on that team and break his team something special. Because if you don't win national championships the way the bar has been set at Alabama, then you're just another team. And you don't get the you don't get to have your name up there with the banners with all the other great ones and all these other things. And that's what he has to do. He has to go out there and win a national championship.
Roman Harper, a Super Bowl champion, a Alabama alum, two-time Pro Bowler. He's got a great foundation that, Roman, if we could ever help you with any of that, man, you make sure that you include us, because certainly we always love to follow your career here in Tuscaloosa, and we appreciate you helping us out, man. It's a lot of fun to catch up, man. I'm sorry I went a little bit long, but you got me energized.
Dude, I'm not doing anything. Hey, look, man, I'm all good, man. I'm out here washing the cars, bro. I'm chilling. I'm a lift some weights later on, hit the gym, try and squat heavy today, try and stay young, and that's it, man.
All right, man. Thank you, Roman. Hey, I appreciate it, man. You've helped us relive some great memories here in T-Town. Thank you again for being a part of the great Alabama tradition, and thanks for helping us catch up with one of the greats when we talk Alabama Crimson Tide football. Thank you, man.
Thank you, man. I'm gonna tell Anthony I talk to you.
Okay, yeah, please do. Please tell, and just tell him to send me another pair of those Alabama shorts. They're almost worn out by now.
All right, 15 years later.